Church of Ireland, the Church of New Zealand and Australia, Kenya and Korea, Chile, the Episcopal Church, the Episcopal Church of Jerusalem and the Middle East, the Episcopal Church of the Philippines, among others. In the Anglican Communion, we have the tradition of naming congregations after people who were personally connected with Jesus or who greatly advanced the movement he brought to earth. So, we have churches named for Joseph and Mary, the disciples, not Judas, the apostles like Stephen and Barnabas and Paul, early defenders of the church, early defenders of the faith, like Gregory of Nyssa, George, Francis, and Clare. And of course, the four who wrote the narrative account of Jesus' life and mission: Matthew, Luke, John, and the first gospelist, Mark. The tradition continues that the anniversary of the namesake's death becomes his or her feast day. And on that day, the people remember and recall and celebrate the contribution and legacy of their patron saint. They bring out the red. They read lessons featuring the acts or qualities of the honored one. They wear their church t-shirts. And they reflect on how well they are advancing the work of their namesake. And they reflect on how well they are advancing the work of their namesake. That is our charge today. April 25th is the Feast of St. Mark. Mark was the first person to provide a written account of Jesus' acts and interactions. He was the only one of the gospel writers who likely knew Jesus personally. His account is not the most beloved. It doesn't give us the unforgettable passages and parables of the Good Samaritan or the prodigal son. It isn't the one used for Christmas pageants. There is no manger or innkeeper in his writings. Mark's gospel is not the most poetic, nor the most quoted. There is no washing of feet, weeping over a dead friend, the love commandment, or the verse held up at football games. But it was the verse. And clearly the ones that followed use his chapters as references and launching points. Mark's gospel was direct, urgent, and stripped down. It was short, fast-paced, and even less nuanced than a 2x4. After reporting the resurrection, Mark brings his record to a quick close. But in his ending, he gives the world Jesus' last directive to his disciples. According to Mark, the first gospelist, the one closest to Jesus, the last words the Lord spoke on earth were what followers then, and he tells his followers today. Your number one charge, your primary duty, your first responsibility to me, to your faith, to your new life in me, is to go declare the good news. Now, beloved, it would have been really, really helpful if at this point in the story, Mark had included a bullet point summation of the good news and a quick how to evangelize guide. But he didn't. Mark lays an idea out once and then he moves on. So it is only by reading his short 16-chapter account with an eye for these details that we discover the way to answer Jesus' directive. How were the first followers to go? What were they to say? How did they make themselves heard? Who was responsible for the world's response to their proclamation? From Mark's earlier chapters, we see Jesus forming the disciples, making them ready for this work. The first thing that Jesus did was to make sure they knew the story. He taught. He interpreted. He opened up Holy Scripture for the followers. He helped them see the essence and the character of God running through human history. Then, he taught them to pray. He taught them how to pause. How to make time to be with God in quiet and in solitude and in truth. He taught them how to connect with people, how to be present to them in their own space, in their physical space as well as in their heart and their mind space, how to do that effectively, how to find people where they were and connect to them in that place. He told the disciples to break bread with others in estates and in hovels, on the plains and by the seasides. He leaned in and listened to concerns. He held the people's pains. He taught the disciples to hold people's pain, to not be dismissive. He taught the disciples to be vulnerable, to admit what they did and did not know, what they didn't understand. He taught them to be merciful. He taught them to be vulnerable in being merciful. He taught them to trust God and to trust the kindness of one another. He taught them to risk appearing foolish for the better understanding of God. Jesus showed the disciples how to tell the truth, how to speak the truth in love. Essential to proclaiming the good news is a willingness to name the good and the bad and the ugly with compassion rather than judgment, and to assert that conviction that God is both able and inclined to redeem all brokenness if asked. And likely, the most important lesson Jesus gave his first followers that ensured the spread of his message was this: right belief is not essential. Aligning with the Spirit of God is. What God most desires is for humankind, all of creation, is to love what God loves. And the number one thing God loves is our proclamation of God's good news in the second decade of the 21st century. In the time of COVID-19, are we bearers of good news? Are we making Mark proud? Festive, St. Mark's Day.